worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his son,
good morning, everyone. How are you today? It is another beautiful day in the house of the Lord. We want to welcome you to our Sunday school, and we want to tell you how much we love and how much we miss you. And so today we want to start off with a word of prayer. We want to pray a word of encouragement over you today, a word of peace to you today through prayer. And we will go into our lesson, and it talks about serving. And we're going to be able to share some awesome things about that through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Why don't you go get your family members, wake those kids up and tell them to come in. And let's look at our broadcast on Sunday school and the husband and the wife. Why don't you call someone and tell them to get on the line or on our Facebook or on our Periscope. But we ask that you would share the word of God with those around you. Amen. Come on and let us pray. Lord God, we bless you today. We thank you for your grace and your mercy today, Father. We thank you for your peace and your power. Lord, we thank you for your preservation of life. We thank you for prosperity in our spirits, in Jesus' name, prosperity in our souls. So we bless those today. We speak even now, Lord God, even through radio waves and through camera waves and the telephone, that you would even now reveal yourself through your Holy Spirit to those who are listening today. So we pray the blessing of Jesus Christ on them. And Lord, we do. We pray and a fresh anointing would fall down upon us. And we pray that we would be filled with the Holy Spirit, that we would be led by the Holy Spirit as we teach and even as we listen, God. Lord, you're speaking to us in this pandemic, and you're sharing with us how much you love us. So we say thank you, and we say we love you, and thank you for choosing us. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray, thank God, amen and amen. Hallelujah. I want to say once more, good morning to you. And guys, you have no idea how much I miss you and how much I miss your embrace. And I want to tell you so many times that I love and I miss you. If you have your Sunday school books, hopefully you do. We are talking about serving today, which is an awesome topic to share about. Serving. And so we're going to share with you today the book of Galatians, where Paul is sharing about serving others. And we know that's what we're created to do. We're created to serve. Jesus came to what? He came to serve. So we know that you have a gift and a ministry in you. And we talked about that a little bit with our DITs online yesterday. I want to say, hey, good morning, DITs. And all of you guys, I'm so very proud of you. You're growing such in great magnitude. And we want to say thank you. And we love you for your studiousness. So why don't you get your Sunday school books? And the first thing it says is, when have you received stellar service? It's important for us to receive stellar service. When we go to restaurants, when we come to church, you know, one of the things that we really want to do and we want to work on is putting out a good presentation. And we know with what we got, we're doing an awesome job, but we know that we're moving higher and higher in our productivity of our broadcast and our service. And so we do. We are always mindful of how we can do things better, that we would be able to serve you, our brothers and our sisters in Christ. Amen. It says, when have you received stellar service? It says, seize the opportunity to serve. Let's read The Bible Meets Life. This is very, very interesting. We've all had experiences with customer service we'd like to forget, but I tend to remember the ones that makes me smile rather than frown. For example, a man booked a last-minute trip on a well-known airline to see his dying grandson one last time. Traffic and long lines at the airport caused him to arrive at the gate 12 minutes after the plane's scheduled departure. But the airline had been informed of this man's tragic situation. Imagine the man's surprise when the pilot himself was standing there waiting for him. The pilot said, they can't go anywhere without me, and I wasn't going anywhere without you. So now relax. We'll get you there. And again, I'm so sorry. Those who travel, and you know, you always have to travel by plane, mostly from Alaska. But when you would receive a service like that, a pilot or a stewardess that is mindful and thoughtful, after tens of thousands of customers, that they chose to be nice to you. I heard this old man tell me one day. He said, people don't have to be nice. And when they are nice, they don't have to be nice to you. Amen. People don't have to be nice. And when they are nice, they don't have to be nice to you. So it's great when people are nice to us. Listen at this. Good customer service is not about making a sale or even keeping a customer. Wow. It's about doing what's right and helping the other person. But we're not talking about customers and business. We're talking about what? Relationships. So we're talking about relationships today. The principle still applies, though. We strengthen our relationships when we help and serve the other person. Serving is a tangible way to love others. Serving is a tangible way to love others. We're going to talk about that in the sense of ministry in a short while. Why don't you go to Galatians 5, get your Bibles, get your pens. This is going to be some very, very interesting things that you might need to transcribe this morning. And it is Galatians 5, beginning with verse 13. Paul is talking to the Galatians, the church of Galatia, and he's sharing with them these truths. He says, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, listen at this, serve one another humbly in how? In love. That is so, so vital. Serving one with love. How many of you have been served, but it wasn't in love? Have you been anywhere where somebody was serving you or doing something for you, but you could tell they didn't really want to do it? You can be pretty uptight with someone like that, because how can you serve someone honestly and not serve them in love? I had a funny example that I shared a while ago with my wife making me a sandwich. It was a little later, and she already came upstairs, and I usually will make my own sandwich. And I said, "Babe, will you make me a sandwich?" And we had a little crazy day that day, and even though she did it, she brought the sandwich back, and it wasn't the way it used to be. She served it to me, and it was like too much mustard on it. It was just a sloppy looking sandwich. And I looked at her, and I could tell she didn't make that sandwich with love. And we laugh about that, because I think I had been pretty petty that day. You know, guys, I always use that. I can kind of get petty at times. I know I might be the only one. And when she brought the sandwich, it didn't even taste like it was made with love. And so she served that sandwich out of obligation. And believe me, spiritually, we can tell when people are doing things and serving us with a loving attitude. Ladies and gentlemen, that is so important. Children, I mean, your children need to be listening to this, because oftentimes our children, they'll do things, but they won't do it out of love for we as parents at times. Even though they're always got their hand out a lot of times, you ask them to do something, they'll do it, but they do it with shrugged shoulders and all kinds of stuff. And you know, and I tell my children, I'm like, listen, you should run when I ask you to do something. Much as we do for you guys, much as you want this. And when we ask you to take the trash out, clean up, you act like it's a burden. And that is how a lot of us do as adults. We serve others out of obligation at times instead of serving out of love. I know I'm speaking to somebody today. And so we have to serve out of love, for the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. Listen, the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. What does it say? Love your neighbor as yourself. I'm getting a little excited. I feel the anointing of Jesus Christ coming upon me right now. If you bite and devour each other, watch out. You will be destroyed by each other. Amen. Freedom is a natural human hunger. We all want to feel free, but sin so easily entangles us and holds our feet to the ground. In Galatians 5, however, Paul reminded us that a revolution has come through Jesus. I hope you're reading with me this morning. Because of his perfect sacrifice, the power of sin has been broken, and we can be free from the downward spiral of sin. Listen, I want to read this, and I want you to really listen to this. Let's look first at what this freedom is not. Our freedom in Christ is not a license to go back to our old lifestyles, to live like we did before we were saved. Notice the word flesh in verse 13. This refers to our sinful nature, the old person that continues to live inside us even after the moment of salvation. And ladies and gentlemen, that happens. Many of us, even though we're saved and we're converted and we are disciples, that there may be times the old sin nature may rise up in us. And it can come through anger, our bitterness, our envy, our jealousy, our whatever comes against the love of Jesus Christ. So that sin nature oftentimes can come up in our life. But I don't want you to get discouraged today, because it's just your sinful nature. It is not who you are. Amen. It's not who you are. We fail almost on a daily basis. whether it be in word, whether it be in deed, or whether it be in thought. Many of us, we may not think the right thing. We may not do the right thing. We may not say the right thing. That old sinful nature. But we have to have that fruit of the Spirit working in us that is self-moderation, self-discipline. And so we have to understand that even when we fall, we got to get back up. We have to get back up and let the world know that I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Even though I failed, that sin nature came up, I still have freedom in Jesus Christ. I still have the liberty of Jesus Christ in me. The flesh is the self-absorbed side of us that can grow like a cancer when let off its leash. It no longer owns us, but it likes to think it does. Paul knew firsthand about the continual pull of the old sin nature. And we all have read the Romans 7, 14 through 24, when Paul is saying, the good I would like to do that I do not, and the evil within me. Do you know in that passage, in those verses, I've studied that passage. And you know, when you see Paul, who wrote two-thirds of the New Testament, struggling with his flesh, you know that we need help as well, especially with so many distractions now in our life. But Paul fell into a sense, listen at this now, a sense of self-righteousness. If you would read that passage, Romans 7, 14 through 24, you can see that Paul says, I... 27 times. He says, I. And then he says it over and over, and he keeps saying, I, instead of Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Not only does he say, I 27 times, 26 or 27 times, he says, me 7 times. Me, me, me. How many of us are doing that? If it's about I, it's I. And then he says, me, me, me. And then he says, myself once. And then he says, my 3 times. I'm trying to tell you, if we keep focusing on ourselves, we'll miss Jesus. We serve because Jesus was a servant. And now that we have taken on the attributes of Jesus Christ, the characteristics, the righteousness, we serve because we get to. That's very important. We serve because we get to. It's a privilege, ladies and gentlemen. It's a privilege to serve. We talked a little bit about gifts and things yesterday with the DITs. But you know what? You have a gift in you. You have a gift, something that the Lord wants to utilize in kingdom building. And many of you are doing it even on your secular jobs as you serve and as you are in your workplaces, you're witnessing and your life's example before people. But you know what? The Lord wants you also to utilize that gift within the church. Amen. He has a place for you in the kingdom. Bless the Lord. The inward focus of the sin nature not only harms us, it affects our relationships. And how many know that? That most relationships fail when the other person has become self-centered. You can say what you want. You can respond any way you want. If you have been through a relationship, one that is broken or one that is fragmented or one that you have been in and out of arguments or whatever the case, you cannot tell me that it's because one person became selfish. They became self-centered. They began to think about their feelings. Yes, amen. Well, you don't know what he did to me. And so we get into our feelings, and it destroys relationships. You know, whether it be marital, whether it be friendship and families, Holy Ghost, families. People's relationships, their families are broken down because what someone has done in a sense of self-centeredness. Amen. So we're talking about serving. If I am focused on myself and you are focused on yourself, how can we ever have a strong relationship? I could camp right there for 3 days. If you are focused on yourself, and I'm focused on myself, how can our relationship become stronger? Do you understand that? Even children, and their parents and children and their friends. And you know, now, you know, the guys are getting into adolescence and boyfriend and girlfriends and things of that nature, and don't really know how to love and don't know how to give. True love gives. Love is a decision. Serving with love is a decision. Even though I know a lot of people with a lot of talent, and you have to be mindful of this, especially on your job and your church, some people are just good at stuff. And so when they serve in different places, they do it because they're good at it, but they don't do it because they love. They just do it because, you know, I'm good at this. And a lot of people have jobs like that. You are good in that job, and you really would like to get out that job, but you're afraid to move from that and serve elsewhere to broaden your horizons, but you stay there because you're good at it. It's comfortable, but guess what? The Holy Ghost wants to move you out of that comfort zone. Hallelujah. He wants to move you out of that comfort zone. He wants you to start speaking to others about him, becoming bold, being filled with the Holy Spirit, to be bold and to love. Romans 5:5, I tell you, that's the verse that the Lord has given me the last 6 months to rest upon, that the Holy Spirit makes you love folk. Oh, yes. And when you love people, you serve them. Oh, my God. You serve them. Hallelujah. Paul also knew that we would find the only remedy for the flesh in an ongoing, listen at this, relationship with Christ. So as we focus on Christ, we also to focus on those who he has brought into our lives. We should maximize our liberty in Christ by loving people through service. Hallelujah. What's the connection between freedom in Christ and the command to serve? The question is asked. What's the connection between freedom in Christ and the command to serve? Well, when we have freedom in Christ, we have the liberty that Jesus purchased for us. So when we take up on that freedom of Christ and loving, that freedom of love, Romans 5:5 said that it's vehemently poured out in the Greek. It's poured abroad. It's shed abroad. Oh, my God. If you only knew that that's not a trickle, that's a gush where it's like a waterfall of love. Hallelujah. A waterfall of love falling on you, gushing through you, that all you can do is love others and serve others. Listen here. Let's go to Galatians 6:1-5. I don't want to stay too long. Let's go to Galatians 6:1-5. Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. We're going to stay right there just for a minute. That's so very important. I've shared this before. You can tell people that they're wrong, and you can do it in such a way, and then you can refer them to how to do things right. But if you tell them they were wrong in a way, and I have to be conscious of this because I've fallen into this, that if you would tell somebody gently when they are wrong, they'll receive it. But if you get in their face and you scold them and then you want to try to correct them, that usually don't work out. Even if you're right, that person has tuned you out, that when you become so, in a sense, it's almost a sense of arrogance. Because the Bible says that you might get tempted in the same manner a little bit later on in this verse. So it talks about, in spite of that person being wrong, you should come to them gently. And how can you do that? Listen, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to share something with you. Many of us, even today, and the Lord is calling us to be accountable. Even many of us today, if we were to see somebody fall, and it's unfortunate, and this is not everybody, that instead of going to them and praying, because you need to pray and ask the Holy Spirit, say, Lord, I know that person is not doing the right thing, and I've heard this or whatever the case. You pray and you say, Lord, Holy Spirit, give me an opportunity to go and share with that person if that's your will for me to tell them about that. Make a time and let us be in the same place at the same time that both of our hearts are prepared to share. I'm prepared to share in love that, hey, listen, my brother or my sister, you know, I saw you do this, or I heard somebody saying that you did this, and I'm just coming to share with you, you know, the love of Jesus Christ. And that person will not jump off the ledge on you, because you've come in love and you've come in prayer. So it says that you should restore that person gently. Restoration, as Jesus restored Peter. 1 Corinthians 15, it talks about Jesus restoring Cephas after he denied him. Listen, this is so very important. After Peter denied him three times amongst many sinners, after he said he wasn't going to do it, and the cock crew, and Peter denied him, and he denied him, and he denied him, and he felt so bad and so bitter about it that he just kind of shut himself off. But Jesus restored him. It says that Jesus went to Cephas, which is Peter in the Greek. He went to him by himself. He didn't restore him in front of the disciples. It's a hidden scene all by itself in 1 Corinthians 15. It says that Jesus went and saw Cephas. He went to talk to Peter by himself. Probably, Peter, I know that you're hurting right now. But listen, I want to restore you. He didn't go to Peter and say, you know you messed up. I told you was going to deny me. He didn't do that like some Christians will do. Oh, I told you you need to stop that. And the Lord is saying, that is not how I do you. The Lord always approaches us gently. He's a gentle spirit. And that's how we should be in leadership. That's how we should be as Christian brothers and sisters. We should be gentle. Because the word says, as we continue, but watch yourselves, or you also may be tempted. And I'm here to tell you today that oftentimes when we start pointing fingers, they say when you point a finger at somebody, how many is pointing back at you? Three. So oftentimes we need to be mindful that we don't fall into that same temptation or whatever your weakness is. Many people will say, oh man, I'd never do that. But it's some other stuff you'll do that maybe that person won't. Because there's Jesus is the perfecter of our faith. He's the perfection in us. But that, like he was saying in the earlier verses, that old sin nature, that pride, that self-righteousness, that arrogance, that envy, that anger, that bitterness, that pointing fingers, that old sin nature rises up. And the Lord is saying, you might want to be mindful of that. Don't be Peter saying what you won't do. Listen, they say never. And let me tell you, the Lord is your strength, ladies and gentlemen. The Lord is your strength. He says, but watch yourselves, or you also may be tempted. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. And the law of Christ is love. If anyone thinks, listen at this, hallelujah, Lord, speak to me, Holy Ghost. If anyone thinks they are something when they are not, they deceive themselves. Each one should test their own actions. Then they can take pride in themselves alone without comparing themselves to someone else. And we know the 2 Corinthians 12 and 10, 10 and 12 says, don't compare yourself amongst yourself. It's not wise. For each one should carry their own load. Hallelujah. That is a mouthful right there. I'm going to skip right down a little bit. One of the most important roles you play in others' lives is to help them see their blind spots. Amen. Now, listen, that doesn't mean you got to criticize everything somebody does, because I know that's right where a lot of people went, because we do have blind spots. Everyone has blind spots. It's like they say, a person looking on the outside looking in. Many people see things that we don't see about ourselves. Amen. You know, many of us, myself included, I thought I was thinner than I was until I walked by a mirror and the truth came out. And many of us today, we just see the good in us. while other people see our flaws, our frailties. And so we don't need to think that we're better, that we think we're higher because, you know, we've been here longer, we've did this longer. And as staying in the church, as long as I've been in church and, you know, being that I've been in church so long that, you know, I know more and I'm better than that person. But we have to be mindful that we must stay humble. We must stay humble so that people will understand and be able to receive. One of the things that I share, and I share this quite a bit, and especially at home with my wife and others, I say, I don't have room for people, for me to get people upset, and it's my fault in a sense that I've instigated it, or I've become angry or bitter at someone, because if I do that, if I instigate or if I cause an argument or a rift and I'm haughty, I can't preach the gospel to them effectively. And that goes for all of us. You cannot share the gospel of Jesus Christ and it would be received if you do it in a haughty, arrogant spirit. It's good to know a lot of stuff, but you know what? The devil knows the Bible back and forth, but he ain't going to heaven. It doesn't matter how much book knowledge that you have, how much love is in your heart, how much love is in your heart. That's what the Lord wants us to see. The Lord wants us to be humble. He wants us to have a sense of humility so that we will be able to share with anyone, not so much being a sense of a condemner. Yes, the Holy Spirit convicts, but he doesn't bring condemnation. The word says, even when your heart condemns you, I won't condemn you, says the Lord. He's not going to condemn you. He's going to convict you, and he's going to be gentle in his doing. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm going to say amen to myself. Praise the Lord. So how can we help others see blind spots in a way that strengthens relationships? As I shared, as we prepare to close soon, I said, if you know someone, now listen, this is someone out there today. This is someone out here today. You want to share something with someone, or you've seen something, or you've heard something, or whatever the case, and you're wanting to share it. So this is how you approach that. You go before the throne of grace. You go to the Lord. You say, Lord, I desire to share with this person because I know it'll benefit them. I know it'll strengthen them. But Lord, do you want me to approach it? Or do you have someone else that will be more effective approaching this? So you pray first. You say, Lord, if it's meant for me to share it, Lord, give me a sign. I don't want to offend them to the point where it tarnish our relationship. So you pray. You say, Lord, put us in the same place, or have the person call me, or allow me, give me a sign. And the Lord is good about giving signs. He prompts you. The Holy Spirit prompts you. He'll put that person on your heart. He'll have you dream about that person. And you wake up and say, Lord, is this a sign? And you look, and then you pray for that person's heart to be prepared, that they would receive it. It's just like fertile ground. You're going to listen. Talking about the gifts of the Spirit, even though you don't know it or not. The gifts of the Spirit, that's why it's so important to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Because the Lord will give you a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge. He'll utilize you in that way, a word of prophecy, a healing. He'll do that, a gift of faith. He will have you stand strong on that. But you have to allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you. And ladies and gentlemen, it's hard listening to somebody if it's always noise around. You're going to catch that. You listen to the loudest voice in your head. I don't care if it's a voice of anxiousness, a voice of fear, but you listen to the loudest thing, whether it be some crummy program that you watch all the time, or some music that you know is not godly. You hear those things more. Guess what your mind is going to do?
If it's always noise around.
That before it listens to the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit has to be the loudest voice. And how can that happen? Read your word. Listen to sermons. Listen to Bible teachings. Listen to the word on your iPad or your phone. Let the word be engrafted in you as the word of God says. And let that word become prominent in your life. And then the Lord will show you how to share with people and utilize the word. And a lot of people don't want to hear that. But you know what? Utilize the word. So they can't say, well, you said it. Nope, the Lord said it. Hallelujah. The Lord said it. So pray, be mindful in prayer. Somebody's got a family member that they need to talk to. What does carrying one another's burden, what does that look like? How can we share others with others about their blind spots? And how can we bear the burdens of others? And that's very simple. Love them. Jesus loved unconditionally. And I know that's tough for many of us. Many of us have been hurt, and many of us have hurt others. There's nobody perfect out there. Yes, I'm talking to you. You have hurt someone before as well. And I know many of us has been hurt. We've been on both ends of that. But the Lord is saying right now that we need to be restored. And if someone even in your group, in your family, in your circle, or whatever the case, they need to be restored. And you know what? The obstacle is you. I can remember just last week when Deacon Coleman preached, he talked about his stepfather. And he talked about how he was mean and he wouldn't forgive him when he would go back home from the military, that he wouldn't forgive him. But he came to a point, and it took some work. He told us it took some time and some effort that he said he knew he had to release it. He started hearing sermons and he started reading the Sunday school lessons. And Sunday school, I'm telling you, is the number one way to learn in church. They say it. If you come to Sunday school, you're going to grow. Amen. That is a statistic. Amen. So you have to be able to hear the word, and the Holy Ghost has to move in you so that you will be able to go to others in love, not in revenge, not as a vendetta, but you go to them in love, because all you got to do is think about Jesus. That's why I take communion almost every day, because I think about his broken body. I think about how he was beat and the blood that was running down from him. Psalms 22 saying that he was beat, he could see his bones and his legs, and many, many scholars say that you could even see his intestines. He was beat so bad. And they say that in the Greek, it's not his stripes that we're healed by. It's his stripe, one stripe, that he was beat so bad that his back literally was opened up where you could see his bones. And we have to go understanding that Jesus did that for us. So who are we to not forgive? Who are we to not serve? God is calling us into service. As I close, Galatians 6:10 says this, therefore, as we have opportunity, listen, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. I've shared this a couple of weeks before. I said, during this pandemic, you know, it'll be some, I don't decree or declare this in the name of Jesus. So I say, I choose my words carefully. There may be some that may never step back into a church building because it's become so convenient. And so now that we've been out now for, I think it's 64 days, now that we've been away so long, that if a root has not been planted in you in regards to Jesus' love in your life and in your heart, then many will think that that's it. I don't have to go back anymore. I'll just hop online. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing, because the Lord, he'll be blessed in that. But you know what? How can you serve others? Check this out. In my clothes, how can you serve others laying home in your bed? How can you serve others sitting in your living room? I'm not talking about your job, but how can you serve in ministry if you are not physically in the building or have some type of connection and a sense of organization and a ministry. And the Lord is calling us to serve. Don't get comfortable, ladies and gentlemen. And we're going to share a little bit about what's going on in the church on our service at 11 o'clock. But it says, do good to those that are in the household of faith. Not that we need to neglect those that are not, you know, because we as a church, we give benevolence to non-members as well as members. That's why it's so important for you to have your tithe and your offering. And as I talk about it, get your offering out for your Sunday school, because we want you to be able to give unto the Lord. So we want you to understand today that God is calling us into service, and you're saying, how can I serve and I can't even get to church? Call someone. Pray with them. The Lord has been putting people on a lot of you guys' hearts, and you won't call them, you won't text them. And you know what? They need a word of encouragement from you. Hallelujah, Miss Shonda. They need a word of encouragement. Serve in the capacity that you can. We was talking to our deacon and our deaconesses. You know, we're talking about driving by some of our members' homes and just honk at them from the sidewalk or whatever with a mask. We're here to serve. And the Lord is saying we must be more creative in this day and this time of this pandemic. So where are you serving? You may used to be an usher, but now what are you doing to serve? God is saying you got to be creative. He's saying you have to be able to serve in spite of COVID-19. So as we come to the conclusion and as we pray, we want you to understand that Jesus loves you. He came to serve and to save. But we are to be imitators of Christ. Amen. That's what the word says. So let's imitate Christ. Let's serve one another. And that starts out with loving one another. Why don't you give someone a call that you haven't called lately and just tell them that you love them? You got 20 minutes before the next broadcast comes on. And just pick the phone up and say, hey, you know what? I was just thinking about you. I love you. Do you need anything? Especially our seniors, our mothers, Mother Hall, Mother Washington, Mother Singleton. Give them a call. I had an opportunity to talk to Deacon Farrell yesterday, and I hadn't talked to him in a matter of weeks. And man, my heart was just overjoyed. So give someone a call. Let them hear your voice. Let them know that you're thinking about them. That's a sense of servitude. Did you know that? You're serving. You're meeting a need where you're filling a void where they may be lonely and they may need prayer. Call someone and pray for them. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, we thank you for joining us today. And we are so glad that we are able to come into your homes and share with you this great word of God. So we ask that you would remain on and get back online for our 11 o'clock service. Don't forget your Sunday school offering. And we, you know that we can give online and you can do it in various other ways. So we want you to say thank you to you. Don't forget to take a selfie of yourself if you desire. And don't forget to mute your phones if you're coming on our teleconference. Amen. Why don't you look around the room and tell somebody that you love them? Even in your living room, in your bedroom, wherever you are. And if ain't nobody with you, go to the mirror and say, I love you. Because it says, treat your neighbor as yourself. Do you love yourself? Amen. Some people treat their neighbors bad because they don't like their own self. Do you love yourself? Amen. The Lord has said we need to love ourselves. Bless the Lord. So let us pray. Lord, we bless you today. We thank you. We magnify you even now for this time of prayer. Lord, we're excited for the word of God today. We're excited for worship today. So we pray even now that we would reach the four corners of the earth in the name of Jesus. Even now, Lord God, that this broadcast, this teleconference would reach all over the world globally. We don't limit ourselves to Alaska, the United States, but Lord, we command this word goes worldwide. In Jesus' name, let your word be manifested in the eyes and in the lives of man, beginning with me. So we bless, Lord God, those who are on the line today, and we pray a covering over them in Jesus' name. And Lord, we pray if someone's heart is heavy, we command even now, Holy Spirit, that you would move and that you would lift their spirits. Lord, in spite of their circumstances, many got bad news this week, but Lord, we know that you are our comforter. So we come saying thank you for comforting us. So we love you, Lord. We bless you. Why don't you tell the Lord that you love him today? If you not told him, say, I love you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, I love you. Jehovah God, Abba Father, we love you today. We thank you for choosing us. And now we give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise which already belongs to you. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray and we receive. Amen. Amen. And thank God. Once more, thank you so much for being online with us. We love you. We love you. We love you. We'll see you again at 11. Join us for our worship service. And we want to tell you, God bless you. Have a magnificent day. See you soon.